You're watching PEGRI TV, Rhode Island's public access channel.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. You've seen that seeing is believing. Your ears and your eyes will be bleeding. Please check to see if you're still breathing. Hold tight, because the show is not over.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Ropes, your official wrestling talk show from the Official Wrestling Museum. We are your hosts. I am Angel, or maybe a little more today, in the Official Wrestling Museum Hall of Famer.
Well, life. Can we be serious? I mean, this isn't a game, dude. Like, we're doing a show, and you're dressing up in a costume.
It's trick-or-treat, smell my feet. I am so sorry. You better watch yourself, because you never know what
be,
might
be
come.
A little professional. We come dressed professionally.
Listen with your eyes and see with your ears. It will all become nice and clear. Don't you worry. Before we go on any further, we do want to send our special condolences out to Wendy, that she's known as Fifi, and also the Nature Boy, Rick Flair, for the passing of her son this past week. Our thoughts and prayers go out to both of you and the entire family. This is the trick-or-treat season. Some people might see it before, some might see it right after. You gotta have fun. We hope all the kiddos have fun in the neighborhoods. Please keep safe out there. Today's show. Is there anything you want to talk about first?
No. I know we got a lot. We're trying to fit like 12 or so years into this show.
We do. Yeah. We do. And, you know, and we do have a couple great topics coming up, like, you know, you heard about WWE doing the developmental leagues on the independent scenes. A lot of great reviews kind of make sense for some of the great, you know, workers with the companies they have on the independent scenes, the training facilities. Some people are also saying, why are you laughing?
It's just funny seeing it on the monitor there.
Oh, now you know. But some people are also saying that this could be, you know, a good or a bad thing. And I thought of something here. What if this is their way of WWE trying to monopolize the independent workers, some of the top great independent workers, to keep them so they don't go to AEW, maybe not so much TNA because they have a relationship with TNA. It could be something there, but I think it's a pretty good idea.
All right. AEW has so many people as it is, so I don't know. I think it's just a way of finding new talent, and it's a easier, fast-track way for new talent to be identified to them. Maybe that's hence the WWE ID, because that's what they call it, ID, right?
ID, yes. Independent development, I think. Yes. That's what they say. Okay, let's talk about Halloween
Havoc.
The WCW version of it. Back in 1989 was the very first one in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. It was, sorry, I'm trying to see with the mask and not my notes at the same time. The opening match had IRS Mike Rotundo in it. It was a pretty good match there. It had the SWAT team, a part of that show as well too.
Versus the Steiners.
Midnight Express.
Okay, yeah. The thing that stuck out, I don't think we have to go over like match by match, but
yeah, because we do have a lot.
Yeah, I think the things that stick out for me obviously was the main event. It was the Thunderdome cage match. Great Muta and Terry Funk, the JTEX Corporation, went up against Ric Flair and Sting. Bruno Sammartino was actually the guest ref. And that was the Thunderdome cage, and I remember at the beginning it caught on fire and Muta put it out with his mist.
That was a pretty cool moment.
That was the biggest thing. I know the Skyscrapers wrestled the Road Warriors in that show.
I was just going to say that. That was a pretty cool match because, you know, back then, you know, the Road Warriors. They were very well over. The Skyscrapers were somebody they were trying to build up.
Yeah, to be with the next Road Warriors,
Right, and I think that was going to, they also had Luger against Brian Pillman.
Yeah, that was a good
NWA championship. So that wasn't a bad show. I'm going to tell you this. I've always been a huge fan of Halloween Havoc. It was just something that WCW was able to put out that always caught my attention each and every year. Halloween Havoc 1990 took place in Chicago, Illinois. Barry Horowitz was able to work a dark match on that show. Still lost, but that was okay. The highlights of that show, you know, you had Junkyard Dog on the show against Mad Dog Rex. It's pretty interesting there. The Mad Dogs were always a crazy team and individuals. The Steiner Brothers took on the Nasty Boys for the NWA United States Tag Team Championships with Scott pinning Knobs. It was a good match. You had Doom against Ric Flair and Arn Anderson.
Yeah.
They went into a double countout.
That was a double. The Horsemen, I guess they were the baby faces of that match, but that was kind of heel-heel, which was unique, you know.
Yeah. Sting was against Sid Vicious for the NWA World Heavyweight Championship match. That ended the pay-per-view right there, and that was actually a pretty interesting match that was taking place at that particular time. You had two, I don't want to say up-and-comings, but up-and-coming stars at that particular time headlining a pay-per-view that I think they kind of nailed it and sent home the show really well. Let's jump to 1991 in Tennessee for Halloween Havoc on October 27th. The show now opens up with one of the guys that was in the main event for the last show with Sting in the original match. In a crazy match and with the Steiner Brothers and El Gigante against El Diamond Stud, Cactus Jack, Vader, and Abdullah the Butcher.
Yeah, this one is notorious for, and this was in the cage, in the Thunderdome cage there, and this one was notorious for having the electric chair in it. And they,
yes.
I think it was Rick Steiner belly-to-belly suplexed Abdullah the Butcher into the chair. They put the thing on and electrocuted him, and he was like,
can you do that again, sir? The show itself was a pretty even flow show. That really stole the show right there on what really happened.
it kind of set the tone for, like, now you had something very, I guess for lack of a better word, kooky every Halloween Havoc now, you know. It had some sort of, like, I know the first one had the Thunderdome cage match, but that wasn't necessarily like a clown-type character gimmick-type match. It was still a serious kind of match. This one was totally, like, totally gimmicky, you know.
Now they had another match. It was Lex Luger defeated Ron Simmons. Now Lex Luger had Holly Race in his corner. Ron Simmons had Dusty Rhodes in his corner. The 2 out of 3 falls to retain the WCW World Heavyweight Championship. The first fall went to Ron Simmons, pinning Lex Luger. The next, Simmons got disqualified by throwing Lex Luger over the top rope, which that was really big back in the day with WCW. You couldn't throw anybody over the top rope, and they had a 20 count outside the ring. And then Lex Luger pinned Ron Simmons after a pile driver. They worked a pretty long match altogether, 18 minutes and 59 seconds back then. You know, for TV, that was a pretty long time frame.
Those are for those two guys.
October 25th, 1992, we've seen the next Halloween Havoc back in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Eric Watts opened the show with Van Hammer.
Vinnie Vegas.
Well, this was a dark match in DDP, in the dark match. You also see Ricky the Dragon Steamboat defeating Brian Pillman. Vader took on Nikolai Koloff. Yeah, thank you. I'm sorry, the mask is kind of tough to see the whole layout of everything that we have going on here. Wasn't a bad show altogether. Ron Simmons, with Teddy Long in his corner, defeated the Barbarian with Cactus Jack in his corner to retain the WCW World Heavyweight Championship on that show. Sting pinning Roberts. Sting defeated Jake the Snake Roberts.
That was the famous spin the wheel, make the deal.
It was.
And Jake.
So what did you think of that match?
It wasn't horrible, but it wasn't great either. It was different to see Jake the Snake. I mean, that was basically it for Jake. He was gone right after this. So he was only there for this one little thing that he did with Sting. But the idea of the spin the wheel, make the deal was pretty cool. I mean, they use it now on NXT, spin the wheel, yep, make the deal. So it's a cool way to put a gimmick match in without just, if you don't have to build up to it, you can kind of just spin the wheel. Oh, we're going to land on this. And wasn't it a coal miner's glove match?
It was.
Yeah, okay.
Yep. And the thing with this, too, is these earlier Halloween Havocs were trying to put that vibe.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
The spookiness.
Yeah, that's what I was saying about, like, when they did the cage match with Abby and stuff.
Yeah.
That the Thunderdome cage was a gimmick match, but it wasn't the same as what it would become, like, with the Abby match. And now they are doing, like, one kooky, I use the word kooky, match per show, you know?
Right. Halloween Havoc 1993 on October 24th took place in New Orleans, Louisiana. It wasn't a bad show at all. Harlem Heat started off the show with Ice Train and Charles Norwood and the Shockmaster. Shockmaster picking up the pin. Paul Orndorff defeated Ricky the Dragon Steamboat by countout. The Lord Steven Regal fought Davey Boy Smith in a time limit draw of 15 minutes.
Yeah, and that was actually a good match.
Yeah.
Probably one of Davey Boy's best actual matches.
Well, you know, that right there, I think, was probably one of the highlights of the show because it was a match that you probably didn't think you were going to get a good quality match.
Right.
You know, fan-wise. And it was like, oh,
as
my God.
As far as Davey Boy, I mean, you knew out of Regal, you know you're going to get top quality wrestling. But to have Davey Boy work a good, you know, I'm sure, you know, yep, mostly Regal helped him with that. But definitely that was his, I think that was his best, you know, he's most known probably for the Bret Hart match from SummerSlam 92. But yep, this match was also very well. I think this match was actually a better match than that one. But yeah, it won't ever get labeled as that.
The American Dream Dusty Rhodes defended and kept his WCW United States Heavyweight Championship against Steve Austin on that by pinning Steve Austin. The Nasty Boys defeated Marcus Bagwell and Two Cold Scorpio with Teddy Long in the corner to win the WCW World Tag Team Championships. We also see the Nature Boy Ric Flair take on Rick Rude by Rick Rude defeating him to retain the WCW International World Heavyweight Championship. And Vader defeated Cactus Jack in a Texas Death Match.
Also going back, we forgot to mention Rick Rude was the Halloween Phantom. I think yes, it was at the Halloween Havoc previous.
That
came
is true
out as the Halloween Phantom. He had the mask on, and yeah, yes, that's how he made his debut.
That is true. You know, Rick Rude, it's interesting. He made a lot of interesting debuts when it came to the WCW brand, one you mentioned there. And he's also when he made the debut by jumping from WWE to WCW again and being the first guy to ever be on both programs at the same time or same night. Rick Rude holds a lot of history.
Rick Rude is
wrestling. I don't think he gets the
yeah, I don't want to say he's underrated, but he's undercredited, I guess, mm-hmm, maybe.
110%. Halloween Havoc 1994 took place in Detroit, Michigan on October 23rd. It started off with Booker T defeating Brian Armstrong. It went on to Johnny B. Badd fought Honky Tonk Man to a time limit draw for the television championship. Now, what's interesting about this, the last Halloween Havoc went to a time limit draw for the TV championship was 15 minutes. This one goes, it's a 10-minute time limit. Now, I know you are a certain television champion someplace, and it has even a less of a time limit.
Yeah.
Pretty interesting on that.
Well, that's because Low Life has found a way to cheat the system, and Low Life has figured out that the average TV commercial break is about 3 minutes. And therefore, you have to beat Low Life within 3 minutes. So it's a three-minute match.
Pretty interesting. Now, we are going to have a lot more information about stuff that he's talking about there and upcoming things very, very soon on these upcoming shows, especially here on Off the Ropes. We also have Pretty Wonderful taking on Stars and Stripes. And Pretty Wonderful did win the WCW World Tag Team Championship. Now, I remember Stars and Stripes. I was big on them. I was big on American Males when they came out. I loved their theme song.
Bagwell was always like that guy that you're like, yeah, you can definitely see this guy being big in the future. And then, you know, he did become big when he was buff. Never a top guy, but top of the mid level.
Yeah,
know?
I'll say that. David Sullivan defeated Kevin Sullivan by countout.
Evad, yeah.
That was pretty impressive there. The American Dream Dusty Rhodes defeated Arn Anderson on this show?
Arn Anderson. That's how we used to say it.
Arn Anderson. Hacksaw Jim Duggan defeated Steve Austin by disqualification to retain the WCW United States Championship.
Do you know that Hulk Hogan had, I don't want to say heat, but the reason why they made David Sullivan like the Hulkamaniac and they cut his hair and everything is because Hulk Hogan thought he looked too much like Hulk Hogan. David Sullivan did.
Really?
Like,
I thought I heard something similar, but I didn't.
Yeah,
know.
Just because they're big blonde guys. They look nothing alike, though. But, yeah, go ahead.
Vader defeated the Guardian Angel. Nasty Boys.
Oh, Vader and Guardian Angel matches were always awesome.
They really were.
They beat the crap out of each other.
Absolutely. And the Guardian Angel is a part of the official Wrestling Museum's Hall of Fame. The Nasty Boys defeated Terry Funk and Bunkhouse Bunk in a match. And the immortal Hulk Hogan defeated the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, with Sensational Sherry, our newest Hall of Famer of the official Wrestling Museum. We announced her right here on this show last week.
She did
to retain the WCW World title.
She did a crossbody off the top of the cage in that match to Hogan, I think.
You know, and Mr. T was a special enforcer in the match. Sensational Sherry did whatever she needed to do any given time to put over the workers and to
actually
pop that crowd.
Sensuous Sherry at this time.
You are absolutely right.
But yeah, she fit perfectly with Flair, you know.
And this
she would have fit in WWF with him even, too, you know.
And this was to force the Nature Boy Ric Flair to retire. Now, let's go to 95 on October 29th. Detroit, Michigan again. Eddie Guerrero.
Infamous. The infamous. I'll let you talk about it, but when we get there.
Eddie Guerrero defeated Disco Inferno. And again, we're just going through some of the matches here, folks. It's not, you know, every single one. Chris Benoit defeated Dean Malenko. Dean Malenko and Chris Benoit defeated the Blue Bloods in a match. We had Sergeant Greg Pickbull Pittman defeated VK Wall Street. Johnny B. Badd defeated DDP. Randy Savage defeated the Zodiac in a minute and 30 seconds.
That's a minute and 28 seconds, too long.
Sabu defeated Mr. JL.
Yep. Sabu had that short. It was just this, and I think he was on Monday Nitro once.
Yeah, very short run. Yeah. Lex Luger defeated Meng by disqualification. Sting and the Nature Boy Ric Flair defeated Arn Anderson and Brian Pillman by disqualification. Hulk Hogan defeated the Giant.
Well, that was the formation. That was the new formation of the Horsemen there. When Sting won by DQ, but really Flair turned on him and joined up with Pillman and Arn Anderson at the time. So
Nature Boy, I'm sorry. Randy Savage defeated Lex Luger. And then the Giant with Taskmaster defeated Hulk Hogan by disqualification to win the WCW World Heavyweight Championship.
And that was also the night of the monster trucks on the roof.
Yes.
They did the monster trucks on the roof, Hogan and the Big Show, the Giant. But the trucks were locked up. They couldn't separate. And that they were just going around in a circle. And then the Giant eventually got knocked off the roof. And then it's like he shows up 2 minutes later for the match. He died and then showed up for the match completely dry. He never fell into the water.
And this was the show of the influence, the Yeti.
Okay, yep, the Yeti
making
came
his
out.
Appearance.
Yeah. Who? This is one of those Halloween Havoc moments. Halloween Havoc, unfortunately, their moments are not, they won't go down in history as the best moments.
Not the best moments, but I will say probably one of the best sets for sure. And the best, oh my God, kind of surprises. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like the Yeti was pretty deep. You know, that was cool.
Was. Next year had a big surprise at the end.
Yeah. WrestleMania 96, October 27, once again, in Las Vegas.
Halloween Havoc. You said WrestleMania.
Oh, Halloween Havoc, yes.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Halloween Havoc 96.
Pat Tanaka was defeated by Jim Powers in a dark match. Psychosis and Juventud Guerrero lost against Halloween and Damien in a dark match as well, too. Eddie Juventud Guerrero took the pin in that one. Dean Malenko defeated Rey Mysterio Jr. to win the WCW Championship.
That was a good one.
Cruiserweight Championship on that match.
That was
there.
A good one.
The Giant defeated Jeff Jarrett by DQ. DDP defeated Eddie Guerrero. Six defeated Chris Jericho. Lex Luger defeated Arn Anderson. Steve Mongo McMichael and Chris Benoit with Woman and Deborah McMichael in the corner, which Woman is in the official Wrestling Museum Hall of Fame, defeated the Faces of Fear of Ming and the Barbarian, The Outsiders defeated Harlem Heat to win the WCW Tag Team Championships, and the immortal Hulk Hogan, at that time the Hollywood Hulk Hogan, defeated Randy Savage to retain the WCW World Championship.
And this was the Slim Jim Halloween Havoc. Macho Man came out in all Slim Jim gear.
Yes.
And the surprise I was talking about was Roddy Piper came out at the very end of that.
He did, and that was huge that he came out. It really started to open the doors up to really play off the whole storyline of what was going on, how everything was going to move forward at that point. 97, Halloween Havoc took place, Las Vegas, Nevada, again.
Yep. Probably has one of the better matches ever on the card, too.
Chris, they were Rey Mysterio against Eddie Guerrero. Titles.
Huh? Rey Mysterio and Eddie Guerrero, probably one of the best matches of all time.
The gear on Rey was awesome. The match itself, this match really put Rey on the map.
Yeah.
For sure, hands down. Alex Wright defeated Steve Mongo McMichael.
Help from Goldberg.
After the match, Goldberg was taking McMichael's Super Bowl XX 20 championship ring by Deborah and attacked Wrath in the ring, Alex Wright in the ring. Jacqueline defeated Disco Inferno. Kurt Hennig defeated Ric Flair by disqualification for the United States Championship.
Yeah, that was after Kurt Hennig had turned on the Horsemen and joined up with the NWO. That Jacqueline Disco Inferno match, that had a lot of internet buzz because they had wanted that match before and Disco didn't want to do it. Then they were going to fire him and he came back and he did that match against Jacqueline. There was a lot of heat with that match.
There really was. That was probably one of the most want-to-see match from fans per se at that time. I think the Ray and Eddie match just kind of stole the vibe once that match hit. By that time that hit as well too. Lex Luger defeated Scott Hall with Larry Zbyszko as the special guest referee. Randy Savage defeated DDP in a Las Vegas sudden death match. And Roddy Piper defeated Hollywood Hogan in a steel cage match.
Or as that one was referred to basically as Age in the Cage. It was not a good match. It was horrible. And it was the same month they did the first ever Hell in the Cell. You can tell which one was much better than the other, you know?
Right. But, you know, still, it was still working. You got to remember, too, at that time, you had NWO playing in the factory. You had to tie a lot of things in. And Halloween Havoc, again, still delivered as per the norm. WCW Halloween Havoc 98, again in Las Vegas, Nevada. Chris Jericho defeated Raven to retain the WCW Television Championship. Wrath defeated Mang. Which that was a pretty good powerful match, hitting a hard-hitting match back and forth between the two of them. Saturn defeated Lodi. Alex Wright defeated Fit Finlay, which was pretty interesting on that one. Billy Kidman defeated Disco Inferno. Rick Steiner and Buff Bagwell defeated The Giant and Scott Steiner for the Tag Team Championships. Scott Hall defeated Kevin Nash by countout. Bret the Hitman Hart defeated Sting to retain the WCW United States Championships, and Hollywood Hogan defeated The Warrior.
One of the all-time worst matches. This Halloween Havoc was
And then
not
you also
great.
Had Goldberg pin DDP to retain the championship.
Yeah, and that one the match got cut off because they ran out of time.
Yeah.
But Hogan and Warrior was horrible. DDP and Goldberg was pretty good.
This was a pretty good match. It was a pretty safe show itself, but you had one Warrior Nation, and there you had to know what was going on with that. It was a very, you know, interesting Bret Hart Sting. People wanted to see that for the longest time.
No.
Scott Hall, Kevin Nash, Wolfpack. There was a lot going on at that particular time frame. 99, we're going to just go over it quickly, guys. Eddie Guerrero against Perry Saturn. Probably your biggest thing, Rick Steiner against Chris Benoit. Rick Steiner. Hollywood Hogan laid down for Sting to allow Sting to pin him in a match, so Sting defeated Hogan to retain the WCW Championship.
Yeah, now you're getting into Vince Russo booking and
very
forgettable, these last few.
The total package against Bret the Hitman Hart, he went over on that. DDP against Ric Flair. Goldberg retained his title against Sting in an uncensored match itself. And Halloween Havoc 2000 took place October of 29. National Born Thrillers defeated panel. Okay, the Filthy Animals. I'm sorry, there was a whole lot of things. Sean O'Harris defeated Disco Inferno. Reno defeated Sergeant AWOL. The Misfits in Action was in action against the Perfect Event. You had Conan. He defeated Douglas on that one. Buff Bagwell defeated David Flair. Jeff Jarrett defeated Sting. Booker T defeated Scott Steiner. Goldberg defeated Chronic in a handicap match. And that was actually the main event of that show.
Yeah, none of it was good. This event was probably the worst.
Yeah, that was and that was your last Halloween Havoc from WCW. So if you go out, you ended it in a 2-on-1 match. And to me, it kind of hurt Chronic more than anything. By making them jab out to Goldberg. They were so much better than Goldberg. One of them is actually in the Official Wrestling Museum's Hall of Fame. He plugged there. The show itself, you know, Jeff Jarrett and Sting wasn't that bad. You know, people were like, okay, we can watch this. But a lot of it just felt like it was just a throw-together show for what was going on at that particular time. I would have rather have seen, you know, either Booker T against Steiner as the main event or Sting against Jeff Jarrett as the main event than what the main event was for that show.
Yeah.
Their sets, absolutely, hands down, incredible. The Big Giant Monster, the Pumpkin, absolutely great.
The Tombstones.
Yeah.
And then since then, NXT's picked up the mantle and done some Halloween Havocs. I like it. You know, it keeps the name out there.
I do, too. I think
I don't think the last one I thought was quite bad. The one that just passed, but
the last one was, it was a pay-per-view.
Yeah, this
it wasn't
that
like
passed,
that
now.
Weekly show.
Yeah. They did do some extra matches through the week this past week on TV, but the pay-per-view itself, I did not really care for anything on it. But I like that they still do the spin the wheel deal, and you know, you get some gimmick matches. It's kind of like replaced the TLC pay-per-view for NXT now does.
Yes.
They all get their gimmick matches and stuff, so
they do.
It's not bad.
Overall, I always enjoyed Halloween Havoc. I think if NXT WWE was to use Halloween Havoc and brought the vibe of Halloween Havoc that WCW was bringing, I think it would definitely get over phenomenal, make it its own show like they did this year. I know you said they did a couple matches still, but still have their own individual show instead of doing it every couple of weeks. I don't know. Halloween Havoc was just that show that I look forward to every single year. And the carnage. And even though that last one, how it seemed like it was just thrown together, at that particular time, it made sense for them to be at a Halloween Havoc type of show, that chaotic. I definitely would have liked to see more like Dungeon of Doom stuff on these shows. You did see a lot of clips of them, but I think you see more matches of the Dungeon of Doom in their storytelling on other pay-per-views more than you've seen at Halloween Havoc. And I just thought it would fit Halloween Havoc a whole much better. Anything you'd like to add?
No, I mean, Halloween Havoc was fun, and concept pay-per-view. And, you know, again, WCW would always say Starrcade was their big event. But I honestly feel Halloween Havoc and Great American Bash were more staples than Starrcade was.
Yeah, I think Starrcade, and it's nothing against who made Starrcade, came up with it. I just
Starrcade.
It just didn't do it for me.
It just was always bad booking.
Yeah.
A lot of tournaments. I mean,
and it was just a whole
year. I don't remember if we
concept the
yeah.
whole year.
I don't remember if we
you know
did Starrcade
and wrap it
year,
up
but,
at that point. But it's like you had a whole year of fighting.
Halloween Havoc, I think you can just have fun with the booking.
Well, you know what they say, though. You know, we thank you guys very much for tuning in. And you know what they say? We'll see you at the mattress, folks.